DJ, Ted Johnson. Ted, good morning.
Good morning, DA. How are you, buddy? Good
I'm great. You, I'm great, man. Can you believe it? It's finally behind us. Brady versus Belichick. There was all of that anticipation for months, and now it's gone. How do you feel?
Yeah, it's weird. It was really weird. I was doing the post game, the other night on NBC Sports Boston, and it was weird when the game was over. I felt, I don't know, I was a little bit lighter. I had this really kind of physical reaction to the game ending and feeling as if so much of everything that we've been anticipating, that we've been talking about, speculating, is. You know, so people around the country know the biggest, obviously, storyline here the last 20 years is Tom Brady and Bill Belichick, and to have them face off, as opponents in a game, in a regular season game, there's so much build up and talk and storylines about the relationship leading up to it, and then that once the game was over, it just felt like, wow, this is a major part of kind of a Boston sports, history. It's probably over now, DA. It's probably been put to rest for a long time, and we can put our focus onto maybe just this team and rebuilding and life without Tom Brady. So I think it had a weird kind of physical reaction to it, an emotional reaction to that game being over. I think for a lot of us that cover the team, it was a storyline that we were just enjoyed covering and talking about. And now that that is over, it's probably a good thing because it probably needs to be put to rest and move on. But that's the feeling around here, is now that we can move on from the Bill Belichick versus Tom Brady storyline and put our focus and attention to other things now.
When you were playing with the Patriots, obviously the relationship between both Bill and Brady was still very good. If it soured, it soured at the end. What do you think changed between when you left the team and, let's say, the last 3 or 4 years for Brady in New England?
Yeah, I think the main thing is, DA, is that really at the essence of the whole thing, why it ended badly, is that Bill didn't believe in Tom anymore. Didn't think that he was the guy to get it done for him, and he wanted to go a different direction. And Tom didn't. That's the difference. I think Tom always thought this partnership was going to ride it to the very end, and that they believed in each other, and they had confidence in each other, and they weren't going to let each other down. I mean, there's so much hurt on Tom's side because Tom felt like he was in partnership with Bill. Bill never saw it that way. It was always the coach-player relationship. And what players do is they make the mistake of thinking that they're different. Yeah, but Bill's that way with everyone else. He's not going to be that way with me. He's not going to give up on me at the end. And Bill did. Bill just wanted to go a different direction, and that's the deepest cut of all for Tom, is that Tom loves and he values loyalty and belief in him, and Bill at the end didn't by way of giving him contracts that, let's face it, weren't even really competitive and were an insult to Tom. And so that's, I think, at the end, what hurt Tom more than anything is that Bill did not believe in him. And if you don't believe in Tom Brady, just watch out, because do it at your own peril, because he will clearly make you pay if you're someone that doesn't believe in him. And that's really, I think, at the end of the day, DA, that was the problem with that relationship.
Ted Johnson, our guest this morning here on the show, former linebacker of the Patriots, 3-time Super Bowl champion. It's such a common refrain amongst former Patriots who at the end Bill kind of cut bait with and might have been expecting a different type of loyalty and didn't get it. Is this, it almost feels like there's a brotherhood amongst you guys that it didn't end great at the end, and now Tom is part of that brotherhood. It feels like this is like this common theme throughout the entire 20 years of the Patriots dynasty.
Yeah, it is for most guys. I mean, not every Patriot experience is the same with Bill. I had a very different experience with Bill Belichick than maybe the next guy, but I have a similar experience with Bill that a lot of my former teammates did, where it doesn't end like you want it to. And you're right, there is a bond there with guys like that. And I think that at the end of the day, is guys want to be associated, DA, with winning. And so that's the hardest thing, is you take less money to play here. You put up with a lot of things to play here that most players maybe wouldn't, because you win. And so you want to stay here. And when you're winning in Boston, D.A., as you know, it's the best. There's nothing better than being part of the sports culture in Boston when you're on a winning team. And we were a juggernaut for so long. And when Bill wants to nickel and dime you, when he wants to make it very difficult for you from a contractual standpoint, it can make you bitter. And it can really put a bad taste in guys' mouths when they leave here, because they just want to be a part of this winning culture. And Bill, a lot of times, he's so cold-blooded and he's so emotionless, and he makes it feel so personal when he doesn't want you anymore. And that's a hard thing for guys to get over, because they just want to continually be playing here and being a part of a winning organization like the Patriots.
I think it's so interesting that you said that Tom wanted to be a partner, but that's not how Bill looks at coach and players. I don't know if Bill looks at coach and coaches that way. I mean, there's always this sense that when assistant coaches leave, they still don't have the keys to, you know, the closet, the true secrets of the Patriots. Do you feel like Bill keeps everybody, including even his coaching staff, at an arm's length?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you want to – and I think the best relationship, D.A., to really focus on and with that, and it's an interesting case study, is the Josh McDaniels relationship. I always feel like even Josh McDaniels probably has to feel like the players feel a lot of times when they're playing or coaching for Bill, is that you're always singing for your supper. You know, you feel like, man, you know, you feel like Josh McDaniels probably doesn't feel like he has anything to prove to Bill at this point, you would think. But yet Bill still kind of treats him like a guy every now and then, as a guy that's got to prove himself to Bill. And so you can sit there, you can say, oh, this guy's an a-hole. I mean, the way he treats me is just, you know, at this point in my career, after all the things I've done for Bill and we've accomplished together, and he's still making me sing for my supper, come on, man. And Bill maybe looks at it like, well, I get the best out of you doing it that way, don't I? You might not like me, but at the end of the day, the end result is what we all want. So it's a very he's just a guy that I think is just doesn't freely give you your due respect, and you're always constantly, as a coach, as a player, trying to prove him wrong, that you're better than what he sees you as. And that dynamic right there sometimes can bring out the best in coaches and players. And that's clearly, let's face it, his coaches probably have it as bad as his players had it too. So I think that's an interesting kind of thing to bring up. But a lot of coaches leave here because he doesn't give promotions. He doesn't get titles, and we all know that he maybe doesn't pay the coaches. And so, but coaches come here because they want, again, be a part of this winning culture and learn from the best. And so coaches and players are willing to put up with things that maybe they wouldn't in other organizations.
Yeah, it's a good point. It's very good insight. Ted Johnson joins us this morning on the show, former Patriots linebacker and winner of 3 Super Bowl championships. If the report is true and Brady and Belichick met for more than 20 minutes after Sunday's game, who do you think that was most important to, and what do you think they talked about?
D.A., that was – you talk about a great Belichick move, and it's a move that Bill has in his arsenal. It is definitely something that he is capable of doing. And what I'm talking about, what did he do, and what am I – I don't know what they said, but I can pretty much guess what they said. And that was Bill in a classic kind of move by Bill Belichick. Is I'm going to go in this right now. I'm going to go extend an olive branch. I'm going to go into the locker room, and I'm going to basically fall at the feet of Tom and say, hey, man, can we put this past us? Tom, I'm sorry what's happened and all the things that have said, but moving forward, can we let the past be the past? I know you – and my feeling is, D.A., he owned a lot of stuff, and he apologized. And my feeling is he – if you look at Tom's press conference – after that Patriot game Sunday night, and it was after him and Bill had that 20-minute discussion, he looked like a man relieved. He looked like a guy that he was just more at peace with things now. And my feeling is, D.A., that Bill went in there and just kind of, hey, let's clear the air. And I bet you that was a very cathartic, and that is Bill Belichick. he has that in him. He can be so hard to deal with, and he can be cold-blooded, and he can shut you out, and he can play games with you, mental games. But when he wants to be a human and he wants to, you know, actually connect with a person, he can do that. He has that in him. I can speak from personal experience. And my feeling is that is what Tom needed. I bet you there is closure with Tom now more than there's ever been in that relationship, because Bill actually extended himself and put himself out there and probably just said, hey, can we have a mea culpa here and let's move on? My feeling was that's what went down in that 20-minute conversation. And that 20-minute conversation that you referenced after the game the other night was probably a huge healing moment for both of them. And I anticipate a lot of the backstabbing and the jabs and a lot of the stuff that kind of goes on, the passive-aggressive stuff through the media and not through the media, is probably over. And because Bill Belichick went and did that DA in the locker room after the game.
Boy, that is so interesting that Bill can be so detached and so unemotional and so standoffish and so prickly. And yet, as you're saying, he does have something within him that will handle a broken relationship head on and admit his faults. I think that for myself and for a lot of listeners, that's very, very surprising to hear.
He has that in him. It is surprising. But that is a classic Belichick move. That he's repaired relationships with Drew Bledsoe. He's repaired relationships, I think, with Malcolm Butler. He knows, all right, he's no dummy. And you can sit there and question the motivation. Well, he's just doing it so the guys will stop talking bad about him. Okay, whatever the motivation is, doesn't matter. The point is, he has that club in his bag, DA, where he will go at the end and just, and give an olive branch. And own up to it. It might be years later, but he has that piece in him to do that kind of stuff.
For years, you worked in Houston covering the Texans. What's your best guess on what happens to Deshaun Watson? Could he be traded before the trade deadline? Do you think that this ends up in the off season? What's your guess?
My guess is it's probably. I could see something maybe going in the trade deadline, and my heart breaks for the fans there. That's a great fan base. They love their football team, and I was there covering that team when watching all the quarterbacks that preceded Deshaun Watson getting there. And everything I talk to all my friends down there, DA, they all say that the fans have turned against Deshaun Watson. That is an unattainable kind of thing, and that there's no way he's going to come back. And so, my feeling is that they're probably going to get rid of him. I'm thinking at the trade deadline. If not clearly, I think maybe at the end of the season. But that is a heartbreaking kind of thing, because that franchise deserves a franchise quarterback. And they had one with Deshaun, and they saw glimpses of what it was capable of doing. And now with all the things that have happened, you just see what this the state of that franchise is right now. It's really disappointing.
Yeah, and the thing is, it's not just the quarterback either. I mean, they can trade Deshaun Watson, get another quarterback, but boy, they got so many things that you can't tell whether it's up or down. And, you know, isn't it just weird how it's gone so sideways for them in such a quick amount of time?
It is, and it's a little bit concerning, because let's face it, Bob McNair, the owner, the original owner, was. He had his issues, but for the most part, I mean, the guy was a good businessman, all right? And I think he had a good judge of people, and he was I think he made some good decisions. You know, and Cal McNair, who's the son of Bob McNair, who's now kind of running the team, there's been a lot of issues now that since he has taken over, and some of the people he's brought in, and there just feels like that they're not heading in the right direction from at least – you know, the upper level management standpoint. And so I just kind of worry about the direction of that franchise, partly because of the leadership in Cal McNair maybe being in over his head a little bit. And so that's unfortunate, because that's a fan base, again, that really wants a good football team. And I just worry about the leadership. I will say this, Nick Caserio, who is now the general manager, who was brought in there from, the Patriots, Nick knows what he's doing. You know, Nick, he's been here for a long time with the Patriots. And I think he is going to get that thing going in the right direction, but it is going to take a long, long time to get there. For-